Yeah, thank you very much, and thanks to the organizers and the student assistants for feeding us and letting us not die here. So I will talk about the conflict, which is like an inner alliance conflict between the German and Ottoman Empire, named, or my talk is named Cultural Imperialism versus Protectionism, on the role of the Deutsch-Türkische Denkmalschutzkommando during the First World War. And Deutsch-Türkische Denkmalschutzkommando for the non-German speakers can be like very bad translated with German-Turkish Commando for the preserving of ancient monuments or antiquities. So I will start with a quote. It's not working. Of Halil Etemeldem, which was the director of the Musée Humayun, which is the Imperial Ottoman Museum. And on April 27th, 1914, when he opened the first Ottoman Museum of Islamic Arts and Culture, he comments in his notes briefly the art policy between the German and Ottoman Empire. I quote, in the Berlin Museum alone, to judge from the images and printed catalogues, many tiles and even whole panels and window pediments are exhibited that have been taken from the mausoleum of Ayub Sultan, the mosque of Sultan Ahmed, Piyale Pasha, Takeji, and Yeni Cami, from the mausoleums of Shehzade and Murad III, the library of Hagia Sophia, and the Baghdad kiosk of the Imperial Palace of Topkapı. Given the destruction to which our greatest monuments have been subjected, the time had come to consider an urgent solution for the preservation of those removable objects that have survived. This is not only an account of claiming more restrictions concerning the translocation of cultural assets from the Ottoman Empire, but further an accuse against the German art policy and cultural imperialism carried out in the Near East so far. Why did Halil Etemeldem call for more protectionist measures then? The Ottoman Empire's territory incorporated cultural assets of more than 4,000 years and testified the settlement and colonization of various antique civilizations. Due to the establishment of archaeology as a scientific discipline in the 19th century and its institutionalization, the Ottoman lands developed into one of the most important sources for antiquities of European museums. Against this exploitation, the Ottoman Empire had implemented its antiquity law in 1869, which you can see here, which was amended in 1884 and 1906, until it prohibited any export of antiquities. The purpose of these laws was the intention to transform the territory of from a field of Western exploitation of antique objects into a sovereign actor against claims of foreign archaeologists and museums. As a result, the export of antiquities was prohibited, but there were still loopholes for collectors. The German Empire, for example, was one of the most important art collectors, which led to the composition of prestige collections of antiquities, especially in the Berlin Museum. Theodor Wiegand. And this is the Pergamon Museum in Berlin and the Pergamon Altar, which you can see here. And funny-wise, there's reliefs of the Pergamon digs outside in the light hall of this university. So the acquisition of antiquities was often based on using diplomatic influences, interventions of the German embassy, and basically friendship between Wiegand and Ottoman authorities. Wiegand played an important role in the German cultural imperialistic politics. He was director of the Berlin Museum abroad in the Ottoman Empire, a position which was established to demonstrate an immediate representation concerning the archaeological activity within Asia Minor and the Near East. Until 1914, Wiegand managed to export a huge amount of antiquities from the Ottoman Empire and enlarged the Berlin Museum's collection of objects, like you can see here. On the eve of the First World War, it seemed like the German Empire took a promising position concerning the acquisition of antiquities, which could have been optimized by establishing the Deutsch-Türkische Denkmalschutzkommando in 1916. After having sketched a very brief historical context, I structured my talk following my research questions, basically. So did Berlin improve its position during the First World War concerning the acquisition of antiquities? Considering the establishment of the so-called Deutsch-Türkische Denkmalschutzkommando, Was it a bilateral formation based on mutual interests, or did the Berlin museums rather try to extend their collection in the Near East using this formation? After becoming governor of Syria and supreme commander of the Fourth Ottoman Army, Ahmad Jemal, that's his area, Ahmad Jemal Pasha initiated the preservation of antique sites in Lebanon, Syria, and Transjordan, and wanted this activity to be expanded to every part of the Ottoman Empire. He wished, and I quote, that not a single Ottoman patriot would lack of respect for the importance of artworks from ancient civilizations, no matter it did arise in Ottoman or older times. In November 1916, the formation Wiegand, or Deutsch-Türkisch Denkmalschutzkommando, was then established in Damascus. There. In 1917, Ahmed Jemal Pasha claimed in a letter to Liman von Sanders, a member of the military mission, the German one, that there are various valuable antiquities within the operational area of the Fourth Ottoman Army. That's Ahmed Jemal Pasha. For this reason, he was, I quote, since a long time searching for an appropriate man who could be able to manage a supervisory commission for the safekeeping of these antiquities, to map and draw them for an academic publication. By fortunate accident, I, Ahmed Jemal, made the acquaintance of Dr. Wiegand. For now, it seems like the initiative was based on Ahmed's interest in preserving the cultural assets. But in fact, after having consulted the German military mission in Constantinople, Wiegand decided with the Director General of the Berlin Museums, Wilhelm von Bode, already in June 1916, to try to be sent and subjected to military positions in the Ottoman Empire, with the intention to do scientific research there. Wiegand's agenda was to examine possible archaeological sites, which were easier to access due to the military presence, or even in far-reachable areas. The German War Ministry agreed to the proposal of the museum's employees. In consequence, they got direct support of the German military command, but it was feared that the establishment of an official archaeological activity within the Ottoman Empire would result in mistrust of the alliance partner. To avoid that, the German museum directors and military officers simply decided not to inform the port about their plans. So Theodor Wiegand left Berlin on August 25th, 1916, in direction to the Near East. Having transferred the reinforcement to Friar Kress von Kressenstein, who was garrisoned in the Near East since September 1914, and was informed about the Berlin Museum's intention to send Wiegand there, Wiegand was sent to do topographical examinations until the German consul Julius Harry Leutweg Hardegg introduced him to Ahmed Jemal. Ahmed Jemal wanted Wiegand to join his army immediately and asked him to prepare a publication about the ancient Islamic sites within his operational area. That was the outcome then. So obviously, the fortunate accident of Ahmed Jemal's meeting with Theodor Wiegand was not that coincidental. As Ahmed said, it was arranged by a coalition of Berlin museums, the German military, and diplomats. But what was the purpose of the commando? Ahmed Jemal expressed the objectives of the formation Wiegand in the preface of the publication 1918. First, he mentioned the establishment of a centralized inspection agency for the preservation of antique sites. Second, the formation should prevent new constructions within and nearby antique sites, the cleanup of ruins, the ban of local population, to use antiquities as source for construction materials. Third, the improvement of roads to the antiquities plus the construction of accommodation to facilitate the visit. And fourth, finally, the collection of antiquities within the army zone. While the first three points indicate a strict preservation or like touristic task, the fourth supposes the actual collecting of antique material and store them in a central location. But Ahmed Jemal refers to the collecting of written material to publish them later on. He aimed on publishing an extensive work which describes the antique sites and would then lead to a raised awareness of the local population plus the instruction to see antiquities as a part of national heritage. But Wiegand wanted two publications, one for the scientific results of the archaeological activity and one for the population. The latter, obviously, because it was Ahmed Jemal's condition. Wiegand stated the value of Jemal's publication in his diary, saying he, quote, expects a lot of the scientific publication, but of the other, naturally, nothing more than a picture book, which I don't want to cover with my name. However, Ahmed Jemal and Wiegand established a modus operandi in cooperating. Usually, Wiegand went on field trips with his team of German archaeologists, architects, and some Ottoman military personnel. They visited several sites during one trip, and then Wiegand sent a report to Ahmed Jemal, who tried to establish measures to protect the antique sites on a local level. In addition to that, the German military mission sent out the order to report every potential threat to antique sites to Wiegand. So can I conclude with the fact that the formation Wiegand served in the Near East for the preservation of cultural assets? I guess, and probably you assume that already, I cannot. I highlighted here a small piece of antiquity which was excavated somewhere in Syria, but I don't know where it is now. There are no sources about that. In addition to these hints of possible finds, a message of the military mission to the Emperor's military cabinet in Germany and the Große Hauptquartier emphasized the importance of the archaeological work and refers to its economic value. I quote, "The military mission supports the proposition of Captain Wiegand and considers the allocation to the military mission also for economic reasons as highly desirable." End of quote. The economic reasons are still questionable to me. What made the archaeological field work invaluable for the military? As a matter of course, there's the topographical work, mapping of the formation Wiegand, which was, of course, valuable work for the military and directly used for several defense and retreat operations, like here they made a plan of Damascus. But I assume different intentions hiding behind the term of economic reasons. At least Theodor Wiegand searched for opportunities to avoid the restrictive Ottoman art policy. Together with Wilhelm von Bode, Wiegand tried to influence the German foreign policy. Together they wanted to convince the diplomats to implement a paragraph in the German-Ottoman agreement for repayment of the German war effort in the Near East, which would reduce the amount the Porte had to pay if the Ottomans were willing to export antiquities to Berlin. In addition to that, Wiegand tried to convince the German embassy in Constantinople to renew and retain the secret agreement between the German and the Ottoman Empire concerning the sharing of finds in 1899. But the efforts were in vain. During the wartime, it was simply impossible for Wiegand to export valuable finds from the Ottoman Empire. Next to the herein before mentioned antiquity laws, an agreement of the German, Austro-Hungarian, and Ottoman army command stated that the transportation of military personnel to the homeland is only allowed to contain items of clothing, equipment, and objects of utility, whereas objects of art are strictly prohibited to export. So in addition to the antiquity laws, there were agreements in charge related to the preservation of cultural assets. Besides, due to the infrastructure, it was nearly impossible to export big finds from Syria. Kress von Kressenstein, for example, reported and complained to the military mission that supplies from Constantinople to Syria or Palestine would need too much time and got to place incomplete. Wiegand saw this impossibility and left the Ottoman Empire in July 1918. He immediately tried to get involved in other nations and to search for other possibility to make acquisitions of antique objects for the Berlin museums. Following Brest-Litovsk and the establishment of new states like Georgia and Ukraine, Wiegand tried to implement agreements concerning the sharing of archaeological finds with the new governments. Already in June 1918, so prior to his departure from Constantinople, he wrote in a report to the German archaeologist Robert Zahn and proposed the finds of the classical epochs for us, the Slavic epochs to the Ukrainians. To conclude, both the German and Ottoman military benefited from close cooperation in military archaeology in context of the Deutsch-Türkische Denkmalschutzkommando's work, especially the maps the commando provided. The studies of the formation are still valuable for science and witness the today partly not traceable condition of antique sites in the Near East. Nevertheless, to come back to the citation I presented at the beginning of my talk, I conclude that the Ottoman Empire pursued a further restrictive export policy concerning antiquities which diametrically opposed the German art policy. In addition to the Ottoman antiquity laws and the agreement within the alliance, the course of war prevented further dislocations of antiquities. Nevertheless, in sending Theodor Wiegand to the Near East for archaeological surveys, the Berlin museums tried to keep their archaeological influence in the Near East alive and even tried to implement the payout of German war effort in the Near East through antiquities and excavation licenses. In fact, the work of the Deutsch-Türkische Denkmalschutzkommando was then the effort to preserve antique sites, but simultaneously it was the last impossible impact of the German cultural imperialism on the Ottoman Empire. Finally, I was able to give you a little insight into my project, and thank you for your attention.